Hi and welcome to another instalment of A Singer's Life, the blog. Now, I'm so pleased that my lovely friend Joanna Forest has not only been able to come and do this interview today, but she's been able to join me on the G4 tour bus.
This is very exciting.
It's
to
so
get
cool.
A little peek at the G4 tour bus.
So I'm so glad that she's been able to come along and join me on here. Very, very much looking forward to asking Joanna a load of questions about her life as a singer, and I'm sure she'll be able to give us some great nuggets of advice as well. So I think if we start at the beginning, very good place to start, and just ask a bit about how you got into singing and when you first realised that this was the career path for you.
Well, I always knew I wanted to perform. Mm-hmm. Ever since I was really little, didn't know if I could sing, but I've always loved singing, always would, you know, like my family would need to have the stereo on in the car when I was little because I'd be singing, singing around the house, and then because I knew that I wanted to sort of maybe do it as a career, I was very lucky I got to go to a stage school.
Cool!
So I got out of going to school because we spent half the day doing singing, acting and dancing.
I'm sorry, what? These schools exist?
These schools exist.
Oh my goodness gracious,
I know,
me. Why did I not know about this when I was growing up?
We only spent half the day doing all the normal subjects.
Oh my gosh!
Yeah.
Wow. I'm not jealous in the slightest. Okay, maybe a lot.
We had an agency attached, which means you sort of get to work as a child.
Oh, that's so good.
Which gives you a really sort of little understanding of the industry. So we got to do things like the Royal Variety Performance.
Oh, that's so
good. Got to do a West End show when I was 13 at the Dominion Theatre.
How amazing that you get to have that experience at that young age.
Yeah, it's very cool. Got to do commercials. Voiceovers, TV programs. Yeah, it was really cool.
Wow, that's amazing. You had so many opportunities. It just goes to show how good you were at such a young age as well, that you got booked for all of those things.
Yeah, thank you. And I think it also sets you up for the other side of the industry, which is like maybe disappointments, all of that side of it.
Yeah, all of those horrible things that go along with putting yourself out there.
Yeah.
Trying to get a role for something and auditioning for something. And well, yeah, there's so many things that you've got to be prepared for like that within the industry. But if you can build that up at a young age and know that it's often not anything to do with you at all, it's just that they might be looking for somebody with a different hair colour. Or it's not that you're not good at what you do.
That's absolutely right. That's what we were definitely told. It could be you're not the right height. You've got the wrong look. They work with somebody older, they work with somebody younger, they work with somebody they know.
That's a good one.
Someone they've used before. There could be all types of reasons, so sort of not to take it personally. I think it sort of, you know, set me up for all of that side of it. But then I realised in the last few years that I just wanted to sing and just do that side of it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What made you decide to do that? What was that sort of light bulb moment that you had?
I think I'd always wanted to just sing, but then other opportunities sort of came my way. Like, I'd even done sort of street plays, like being a maid in a Bernard Shaw play.
Oh, cool!
Yeah, that type of thing for the Shaw Society. So I think things just sort of kept sort of coming my way, and if you don't sort of change things, then you end up doing the same things sort of keep happening to you, don't they? So I think I was ready. I said no to a few things and I didn't mind.
Wow.
Yeah.
Okay. And that's nice.
Yeah.
That's really nice that you felt in that position.
Yeah, because it was stuff I'd done before, and I think you're sort of always guilty of thinking, I've got to do this and I've got to do this, because it might lead to this, and if I do this, someone might see me and choose me for this, and then you think, well, maybe it won't. So I just focus, do the singing.
Yeah. And you went into classical crossover.
Yes.
What was your decision behind that, having come from musical theatre and stage and that kind of thing?
I kind of just wanted to do it.
Right! That's the best answer ever!
Yeah. It's what I wanted to do.
And then you got an amazing opportunity to sing with Paul Potts, didn't you?
How amazing was that?
It's really cool.
Singing with Paul, we sung Point of No Return from Phantom with the orchestra. I just knew that's what I wanted to do.
That's great when you've got that in your head, because I really feel like when you say you want to do something, you enjoy it, I've always said that that's half the battle won with anything, because then you're willing to spend the time on it, and you're willing to learn as well, because when you're getting into something that's completely new and different, if you say to yourself, but I really want this, you want to spend the time then learning how to achieve it, don't you?
Oh, so much to learn. Yeah. Whether it's social media, blog writer, Facebook algorithms.
Gosh.
What? It's also confusing.
Record label as well, when you're releasing your own albums, you're the only person who can say that with their debut release, they got UK Classical number one, which is absolutely phenomenal. And I remember talking to you about the whole process and all the different hats you have to wear in order to get all these different jobs done, and it's crazy. Could you walk us through the thought process you had of, right, I'm going to do an album.
Yeah.
And then getting to Classical UK number one. Take us through that journey.
Well, it was so enjoyable, all the different parts to it. So first of all, you have to decide like what's going to be on the album, but you have to be careful with your song choices if you want it to be classical chart eligible, because they have some rules that's different to the main chart. You have to double check with the chart, so it has to be eligible in the first place. And then I recorded mine with the City of Prague Philharmonic Orchestra, an art symphonic orchestra, so how lucky is that? Like, so lucky. So yeah, decide what's going to go on the album, get it chart eligible, then you have all the whole recording, which is really exciting. Then it's sort of like getting it out there as well, and if you are independent, then you don't have obviously the force of a record company behind you.
No.
But if you have a good PR team anyway, then that's so massively helpful. And things like Facebook are really useful to get your message out there to people who are already fans of the genre. You can put your message out to people who like maybe similar artists or who like similar music, which is really clever.
It is clever.
It's very clever. Yeah.
And a little bit Big Brother-y at the same time.
Massively so. I don't know whether I 100% fully understand utilised it to its full capacity, because I think it can go like very sort of precise. It's really, really clever.
But this is what you were talking about earlier, about it constantly being a learning curve. There's always something else you could be doing, or always something else that you could be utilising all the time.
All the time. I know. And then it was just trying to get the message out there that I've like got this album and I've recorded it, and spent a good few months just being very asky to people saying, please buy it.
Yeah, but you had a good reason to asking people to buy it, didn't you? Because you were working with a charity that's very close to your heart.
I was working with the awesome Copperfield, who are a breast cancer awareness charity, who are amazing and save lives. And I volunteer for them because I had breast cancer when I was 21, and I just think that message that it can happen to you at any age isn't really out there. But Copperfield are doing their best to change that. So I was delighted to be able to help Copperfield because they're amazing.
Yeah.
I'm very proud to volunteer for them, which was brilliant. And anybody who sort of hears about the charity, who hasn't heard about the charity and understands what they do, immediately wants to get behind such an amazing charity.
You're so right when you say that anybody who hears about Copperfield as a charity really wants to get behind it. Even the Sun really got behind Copperfield as well, didn't they?
Yes, they absolutely did. And I don't know whether you remember, but there was this whole Copperfield takes over Page 3. The Page 3 girl would check herself for breast cancer on a Tuesday, which is...
That's great!
I know! The amount of reach that got to was, like, amazing. It really, really was. The Sun were brilliant, and they also sponsored a concert that me and my husband James put on.
Amazing.
We called it Busting to Sing, and it was at
the Palace Theatre. Busting to Sing, yes, good.
Yeah. And any artist who we approached to sing, as soon as they found out about what the charity does, they really wanted to help. We had so many wonderful people give their time. Joe McKeldry, Ridian, Paul Potts, Francis Raphael, Louise Dearman and Shane Ward.
Amazing.
Alistair Brammer, Kingsland Road.
Oh my gosh!
I know!
So cool!
It was a very cool night. Yeah, it was lots of fun.
And I remember you saying you really got to focus on your new direction of classical crossover that night, didn't you?
I totally feel like it was singing with Paul and the orchestra. It was like the epiphany moment of, like, this is what I should be doing.
Oh, that's so cool. Do you think maybe your experience with the fragility of life so early on in your life, age 21, do you think an experience like that helps you have the courage to go and pursue things that you really want to do in life because you're aware of how fragile it is?
I hope so. I definitely think that you should, if you can, follow your dreams, I guess, because I suppose you only get one chance, don't you?
Right, now as we're good friends,
yes,
we've been sat here chatting.
We've been chatting as well as answering questions, to be honest.
Yes. And as you can see, time has rolled on and we've now had to put the lights on in the tour bus. Hopefully you guys can see us a little bit better now we've turned the lights on. So as this vlog is called A Singer's Life, I thought I'd ask you what your general day-to-day life as a singer looks like.
Yeah, so as you know, it's never the same.
No.
Never the same. So on a day when I'm lucky enough to have something where I'm going to be singing, if I can, steamer. Have you got a steamer?
No, I've got the very old-fashioned kettle, bowl and towel over my head.
And I like to get up early so I can talk as much as possible, because I feel like that warms your voice up.
It does.
Oh, and maybe like try and go to bed early the night before to sort of rest everything. And then, I might think about what I'm going to wear. And I like to get to a venue quite a lot of time before if I can.
I do that as well.
Yeah.
Yeah. I know a lot of singers who don't want to be in the venue because it just makes their nerves worse.
Really?
But for me, it makes my nerves worse not being there.
Yeah. Because I'm going to be late.
Exactly.
Is there going to be a problem with the journey?
Exactly. I'd much rather get there and go, right, I'm here now. So if there's any problems, I can sort it out. I can get ready nice in advance. I understand people when they say, oh, I don't want to be there because it makes my nerves worse, because they know that the stage is right there and I have to go on there later. But I don't feel like that at all, because I just feel like I want to be there and prepared and go, right, I'm ready.
Yeah.
And that makes me feel so much better.
Definitely. And it also gives you a little chance to maybe do some social media type things.
Oh, of course. Yes, isn't it?
Social media.
Yes, you're there early. And then there are the days, maybe, before an event, maybe you've got stuff to learn as well. Practicing, trying to learn words. What's your preferred method of learning words?
I test myself by writing them down on a piece of paper.
Get a piece of paper.
Good old pen and piece of paper.
Yeah.
And if I've got a backing track, I just constantly test myself.
Yeah.
Rather than singing along to the track with somebody else singing, because that's actually a prompt.
Yeah, it is.
I have the backing track, or I sing it along to myself and write down the words. I find that the best way.
Yeah.
How about you?
That I like doing that type of thing as well.
Yeah.
If it's in a different language, like French or Italian, then that will take, for me, a lot more preparation.
Yeah, I agree.
And learning. So they're sort of days of that type of thing. Last year when I did my tour, there was like a few days of making sure I knew words and everything was right to the backing track. Another thing that takes up a lot of time is admin.
Oh my gosh.
It's so boring.
Oh, I'm under a mountain of it all the time.
Singer/secretary. Exactly. So I've never done a job where I've worked in an office. So emails to me have always been to friends. And so it's sort of getting that sometimes if you have to be a bit businessy. Sometimes I get a business one back and I think they've been a bit cold, but I don't think they haven't.
Well, because they don't have a smiley face at the end, like what your friend would do.
No, emojis, there's no kisses.
Yeah.
It's very direct. They don't like me. No, that's just a normal email.
Oh, gosh, yeah.
But, you know, admin can be hard.
But it's not only admin with organising your gigs and your tour or anything. It's all the admin of creating your next lot of content for social media.
It's about being creative with your social media on a day when you haven't done anything interesting.
Well, the thing is we think it's not very interesting. Like, so if you weren't coming today, I'd be hanging out on the tour bus, probably watching Friends, because that's my addiction.
That's how you're rolling right now.
That's how I roll.
Do you know that, just a little interesting fact, that I actually saw Friends being filmed live. I was part of the studio audience.
I'm sorry, what? Excuse me? What did you just say?
Part of the studio audience.
That's quite cool, isn't it? Oh, I don't think I've ever been so jealous of somebody in my entire life. Oh my gosh, that's so amazing.
Cool. It was very cool.
Right, getting back to singers, friends. Talking about things being boring, like, because I would have thought I'd just be getting on with admin today, watching Friends episodes. But
that would still be interesting to somebody, wouldn't it?
Because I'm on a tour bus,
And it's G4's tour bus, and you're part of the tour.
And what admin have I got to do as a singer, and that kind of thing. So yeah, even when you feel like you're not having a very interesting day, like, I've had days where I've just stayed at home in my office, in my studio room, replying to emails the whole day. Probably still in my pyjamas by the afternoon, most likely. And that, to me, that's not a very interesting day, because I'm just sat there at my laptop the whole time. But the stuff I'm talking about with people doing these emails could actually lead to something really interesting. So it's a way of saying to people, you know, I haven't really been going out and doing anything today, but I'm still plugging away behind the scenes all the time.
Totally. The other thing that can be quite time consuming is also sort of connecting with people on social media. That takes time. You have to actually be on social media to do that, don't you?
Mm.
And if you want to sort of reach out maybe to other artists, you've got to follow them and see what they're doing.
But I love that about classical crossover, because I feel like whenever you've got another person in that genre that is interacting with you on social media, it's not because they're necessarily spying on you.
Mm.
It's because they love the genre and they're genuinely interested and want you to do well.
It's so encouraging. If someone's done something amazing, everyone's so pleased, aren't they? Like your brilliant songs of praise, The Big Sing. Like, that was so amazing. And everyone's like, that's amazing.
That was so exciting. And then Scarlett Quigley going on The Voice as well.
Amazing, with three judges turning round, that I think is very unusual. Flying flag for classical crossover in an amazing way.
Absolutely, and showing that young people can really enjoy our genre. Like, what an amazing ambassador for classical crossover music.
Yeah.
And to be on The Voice singing that beautifully, it's brilliant. So that's exactly what I'm talking about. When somebody does something where you're like, wow, they're doing really well, you're like, yes! Go for it, go on, take that opportunity and make the most of it. I've said to a couple of people recently that, I actually said it to Kyle Tomlinson, who is one of the...
on your EP,
exactly,
it's amazing.
He's got such a brilliant, beautiful voice, and he was Golden Buzzer on Britain's Got Talent. He's had such an amazing start to his career. It was David Walliams who pushed the Golden Buzzer for him. And I said to him that it's great that you've had this amazing start, but you are the only person who is responsible for making your dreams come true.
That's such good advice. Yeah, that's absolutely it, yeah.
So when you're constantly plugging away behind the scenes, it's all for exciting things. But then it's also great that you're in this classical crossover genre and people want to support you with that. It's such a lovely community and family feeling. I think we're lucky.
I think we're lucky. And the lovely fans who really want to help independent artists are so loyal, aren't they?
Yeah.
And they really sort of get that it's harder if you're independent, and they really want to help.
Yeah, and they're so friendly. So friendly. Like, I spend hours on social media chatting to people just because they're so nice.
Yeah.
Yeah, I feel like I've made some really lovely friends.
Yeah.
Not only the artists, but the fans in classical crossover.
It's so nice to see the familiar faces at the concerts, isn't it, as well?
Yeah. Yeah, because you know that they're genuinely enjoying what you're doing as well.
Yeah.
And that's always a nice feeling. And I think that's another great thing about social media now, is that you're able to actively ask your fan base what they want from you as well. You've got that market research right in front of you.
Right at your fingertips. That's such a good point. You can throw out any question and they'll come back and be really helpful.
Mm. Exactly. And they're always really helpful in a really lovely way, because they want to see you succeed.
Yeah, exactly. I really feel like they're totally behind us, aren't they? Which is really nice.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
So, seeing as I've got you here, on the G4 tour bus.
Amazing, on the G4 tour bus.
So cool. I really want to know if you've got any great bits of advice that you can pass on to the young singers that I'm working with for the EP.
So the singers for the EP.
Yeah, so if you're talking to any young singers.
Yeah, so you've got some fabulous singers on your EP.
Well, I think so. They're great.
It's going to be an epic EP. Get down with social media. So I would say, work out how it all works. The ones that I can't get my head around, like Snapchat.
Oh yeah, I'm not on that.
No, no.
But then none of my fan base are.
That's very true.
Know where your fan base are. Yes. And focus on that one.
Yes.
You're so right about social media, because that's the best way that we can reach out to people now. We can have great communication.
It seems like the way, doesn't it? I think, obviously, TV is the massive biggie, but, the opportunities for that are few and far between. It's sort of like another way to reach out to people, and lots of people that you don't know as well.
Yeah, exactly. And I've said to the young singers that I'm working with, that if their branding is right, so they've got the same name for each of their social media accounts and the same pictures, it makes it easy for people to find them. Because a lot of the time, it's really difficult to get your name exactly the same. Like, I couldn't do it, even though there's nobody on Instagram called Mary-Jess Music, it still won't let me have that name. And I don't know why, so it's Mary-Jess_Music, but my pictures are all the same. So it's a way to help people find you. But any other bits of advice that you've got from all your time performing on stage?
I'd say perform as much as possible, wherever it is. Say yes to it. Go perform. Do it. Because there might be somebody that's going to like you, and you sort of, and then will follow you and support you. So as much stage time as possible.
And I agree with that.
And then if you do lots and lots, then when it's sort of like a big event, then you'll just be easy breezy more so about it. Then you don't want to be in the position where you think, I haven't been on stage and sung for a while. You just want to be like, and then you'll feel more relaxed. Also, I think being prepared is a brilliant way to feel as relaxed as you can be on stage.
Completely agree.
What other advice would I say? Really try and connect with people on social media. If they've given their time to comment on something and say they've enjoyed it, then it's nice if you say thank you back, isn't it? And you give your time back.
Absolutely.
Rather than posting and then just like ignoring a whole load of nice comments.
Because it's because of those people that you're able to sing, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's thanks to them. And I think it's so important to not only say thank you, but show that you're grateful for that.
Yeah. Oh, I probably should take this advice rather than just sort of dishing it out. But don't be afraid to big yourself up, not in like a big-headed, arrogant way, because nobody likes that. But then on the other side, if you don't sort of do yourself down as well, does that make sense? Like,
I think you need
to find the right sort of balance. Like, you don't want to be showy-offy, but then you don't want to be putting yourself down either.
Yeah, I know completely what you're saying, because it's really difficult to strike that balance.
I think if you can strike that balance, then that's a good thing.
But it's like what you were saying earlier. Like, Joanna's got this amazing new showreel, which you will love. We should definitely put a link to it somewhere so that we can find it, because it's great. But you said earlier you were afraid of putting it on your friend's page on Facebook. But surely your friends would want to see that.
They're so nice. You sort of just feel like you're going, don't be afraid, this is the advice, to be a bit like, look at me on social media, even because you don't know who is going to see it. Supposing somebody sees it and they really like it, then they become one of your supporters. I mean, that's really special, isn't it, to get somebody who's a supporter.
Absolutely.
So, I would say a piece of advice, don't be afraid to be a bit look at me, because the more you post, the more it goes out, and then the more people see it, and it's all this big thing.
And the whole idea of social media is to reach out to people who haven't
Who don't know you as well.
Yeah, so yeah. I've had a lot of people come onto my channel who don't know anything about the Chinese X Factor.
Wow.
Or anything like that, because they're just discovering me for the first time.
Yes.
And so
you maybe seen you with G4 and they've enjoyed your performance and they go to your website and then they're like, oh, I'm mentioning the Chinese X Factor.
Yeah, but they're not aware of that beforehand.
Yeah.
And so there's great tools that you can use on social media now, like Throwback Thursdays. Where you can go, oh, I'll throw back to when I did this, that, and the other. And it can come across as show-offy, which is difficult, because then you're like, ugh! So I completely understand what you're saying. But when you're reaching out to new people, they don't know about that. Yeah.
Maybe we need to do it, throwback Thursday, and then just give a little hashtag saying, hashtag show-off, hashtag sorry, not sorry. And just sort of own it.
I like that idea.
Or for people who don't know.
Yeah, because you're constantly trying to look out for new people and you want them to, they want to know more about you.
Yeah.
So you want to be able to provide that content because that's the whole reason why they're following you then, isn't it? Because they want to know more about you. They want to hear more of your music. So if you can say to them, you know, I do have this back catalogue and I got UK Classical Number 1, my debut album. Like if you can tell them that, they'll be like, wow, well, I really want to hear it then because they've got an invested interest in you because they're following you. So it is important to have that information out there, but I completely get what you're saying, where it's like a really difficult balance. You're like,
should I not?
Yeah, it's scary.
It is. But then I suppose you're never going to please everybody, so we should post what we want to post.
It's a good bit of advice.
Yeah, see, we spend hours talking about this type of stuff, don't we?
We really do. And I'm so glad, I'm so grateful that I get to chat to you about this stuff. So now I guess I just want to say, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you for coming in.
Interviewing me, letting me be on your singer's life.
Yes, vlog. On the vlog, and for coming on the G4 tour bus today.
It's pretty cool. A tour bus is cool, isn't it?
It's cool.
You've got like sofas and everything that you need.
Kitchen and two lounges and 16 bunks.
That's pretty cool.
It is cool, isn't it? I like it.
I'm glad I've seen it.
It was cool. But yeah, thank you so much for coming along coming on the tour bus and sharing your life as a singer and giving some great bits of advice to young singers as well. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Joanna Forest, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye.